أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحاب الأجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته first of all, Jazakallah khairan, you know, for giving this opportunity, especially to brother Osta, that I happen to know him just for the first few months. And I think the I3 Institute is doing a wonderful job. And after a long, long time, you know, I came across, you know, individuals like brother Marish and brother Osta, who are truly principled, you know. That I feel now that, you know, that I was a lone warrior. Now at least I have two more brothers, okay, who will stand shoulder to shoulder with us on principles, inshallah. Few disclaimers. I'm not a scholar. So please, you know, don't take everything that I say, you know, as a, you know, coming out of a scholar. Mashallah, you know, the two brothers over here are much more knowledgeable than I do. Also, you know, in my conversation, I will say things sometimes, you know, that are very harsh. Just 2 days ago, there was a WhatsApp communication with one of our very good friend, mashallah, he's in Saudi Arabia now, brother Basil. And he said to me, brother Farooq, you are going there to speak, wonderful, right? But please, you know, be more sensitive, because the audience there, you know, will mind what I will say. I wrote back to brother Basil, right? I said, I speak nothing but the truth and nothing else. So in that process, you know, if people's feeling get hurt, then, you know, I apologize in advance. When we talk about identity, what do we mean by identity? The word identity basically means it is a reflection of one's personality in his belief and his actions. So whatever we believe, we act upon it, and that constitute our identity. So for example, you know, Bush, you know, or Tony Blair, or Netanyahu, you know, they're all serial killers, right? How do we know? Because that's what they believe and that's what they did. You know, they went and they bombed, you know, Iraq, which is a mess, you know. Netanyahu has been killing, you know, Palestinians for a very long time. So whatever people believe and they act upon it, that becomes their identity. So it's a similar thing for the Muslims as well. Whatever we believe and whatever we will act upon will become our identity. So if we believe in submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the concept of Tawheed, and we act upon it, how? By praying, you know, by giving zakah, by going to Hajj, you know, by fulfilling all our rights and responsibilities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put on us, that becomes an identity. So the topic today that while I was, you know, driving and for the last few days when I was told that I have to speak, there is a crisis of identity among Muslims. Few days ago, I was talking to Imam Shahriyar, mashallah, very knowledgeable person, you know, and has been, you know, an inspiration for me for a very long time. And we were both talking, and his opinion was that Muslim knows their identity. And I was arguing with him that, in my humble opinion, Muslim does not know their identity. They are confused. And when I say they are confused, is because their beliefs is not being transformed into their actions. Because if they are not confused, if they are know, you know, who they are, what they stand for, then they will act upon what they say. So for example, you know, we see in the last 10 years since 9/11, issues have been thrown on us like polygamy, for example, right? Or jihad. You know, everybody says, ooh, jihad. You know, nobody talks about jihad, right? You know, or even if they talk about jihad, right, they say, oh, well, you know, it's a jihad bin nafs, right? You know, and, you know, jihad bil khalam, you know, and we are all supposed to be good Muslims, and we must be in the mainstream, you know, putting our votes, right? You know, and electing, you know, individuals, right? You know, who are so-called, quote-unquote, Muslims, right? So that's jihad, brother. You know, we should go out, okay, and feed the hungry. That's alhamdulillah, that's well and good. These are all different type of categories. But very, you know, often we come out and be very precise and clear that there is also jihad bil qatal, you know, there is a sword. Rasulullah was not a pacifist, you know. He went out and he fought wars, you know. Badr, Ahad, you know, all these battles, you know, were fought by the Prophet himself. But what happened is that because of the social pressure that is put upon us through media, you know, whether it is social media, through our colleagues, we always try to, you know, mush things. For example, recently, when the sex education curriculum came out, and there was a lot of hue and cry, and shamefully so, a lot of the imams were coming out and saying, oh, well, you know, there is nothing wrong, okay, and they only talk about, you know, biology, you know, and I remember watching a program on Steve Paikin, The Agenda, where Shabir Ali and the imam from the Makki Masjid, what's his name, I forgot, Umar Subeda, Jazakallah, were both there. And Steve Paikin, I mean, you know, we sometimes think, right, that the white people are stupid. They're not stupid. They know exactly what they are talking about. But they want to put us on the spot. So he asked, I say, is homosexuality compatible with Islam? So obviously Umar Sadar was trying to be mushy, right, and say, well, you know, this, that, right, okay. What was most surprising was Shabir Ali said that it is compatible with Islam. Now, either Shabir Ali has not read the Quran properly, you know, or maybe his U of T, you know, PhD has really, you know, messed him up. And I think the second part is more correct than the first one. And I know him from university, by the way. And I was amazed. I said, wow. I mean, he runs a program called Let the Quran Speak, and he is saying it that homosexuality is compatible with Quran? I was speechless. Now, the reason a lot of the time people say these things, right, is because in the back of the head, right, they think about their positions, you know, they think about, you know, their colleagues and their jobs, right? You know, if I say the wrong thing, then, you know, I'll get kicked out from my work, you know, or I will be demoted. But if we have iman in our heart, and if we fully and completely believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of all and He will provide the sustenance, then we will stand our ground. So again, what we believe and what we do are not compatible. You know, they are not together, they are not in sync. And therefore, as Muslims, first and foremost, I believe, is that we need to start working on our iman. That we need to understand that as Muslims, we have a unique identity in the West. You know, a lot of the time I see Muslims coming and say, you know, brother, we need to be in the mainstream. Well, what do you mean by in the mainstream? You know, should I start, you know, start dancing, you know, going to clubs, you know, have a girlfriend or something? Okay, fine, pizza, right, and hockey is fine. But other than that, what is mainstream? You know, what do you mean by mainstream? And they could not explain. Then they, you know, go like left, right, you know, they're all confused, right? No, brother, we should go and put our vote. Mashallah, you know, we have elected two Muslims, you know them. Do you know any one of them? Do you know who two Muslims we got elected in the federal election last year? Anyone? Okay, well, that's another character. I'm talking about the other two. One is called Ikhra Khalid, and other is Salma Zahid. Okay? And both are useless. I'm sorry to say that both are useless. Because I'll tell you why. You know, they both are Muslims, and they're both Pakistanis. And when I approach both of them in the last few months, and I asked, I said, you guys are Muslims and Pakistanis, and you are sitting in the parliament, you know, there is a massacre going on in occupied Kashmir right now. where the Indian forces have blinded 500, you know, women and children and men over there. Are you going to speak on that particular issue and bring a protest resolution in the parliament? I mean, that's the least they can do, right? Forget about, you know, putting sanctions, you know, on India, you know, and everything. No answer. I mean, literally, Iqra started trembling and she wiggled out. She ran. Now, she thought that, you know, I'm like a typical Desi, right? You know, she's going to offer me something and say, okay, you know what, I'll get you a job or something. So her manager sent me an email saying it, oh, you know, Iqra has asked me to send you an email. It was very delighted to she meet. What can we do for you? Okay, so I thought, okay, well, she's trying to bribe me now. Typical Pakistani. By the way, I'm Pakistani too, so I wrote her back. I said, you know what, there's nothing on the face of this earth that you can do for me. What you can do for me right, is to speak against the Indian atrocities in Kashmir, in occupied Kashmir. And to this day, I have not received an answer. So what I'm trying to get to you is, brothers and sisters, and I see a lot of young people over here, is don't be afraid to speak your mind. Whether it is an issue of polygamy, whether it is an issue of jihad, you know, whether it is an issue of women's, you know, status in Islam. Recently, you know, I came to learn that we have another Sheikh, right, you know, Sheikh Musle, who got appointed as the police chaplain. And, you know, media started to bring out his previous speeches and said, oh, okay, well, you know, he's a misogynist. Well, I tell all the feminists, right, that, okay, you know what, I'm not a misogynist, but I'm a massager. And what I came to also learn is that Muslim also started to, you know, wiggle. Instead of coming out straight and saying it, yes, Allah has created, you know, a woman 1 degree below man. If we submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then every word, every comma, every full stop, every, you know, little mark in the Quran is the last word for us. No compromises over that. Come what may. That's the attitude that we need to adopt. And, you know, then they come back and they bombard you with things like, oh, you know, you're a fundamentalist and you're an extremist and you're an orthodox. Okay, and then quote-unquote terrorist. Okay, fine. We are. You know, if somebody wants to call me a terrorist, so be it. Not going to hurt my feeling. I am a fundamentalist. So what I'm trying to draw over here is that again and again and again over the years, I have come to learn one thing. That if you are honest, if you are truthful, if you speak your mind in what you believe as is, without mushing things, then the other side is going to respect you. You know, a lot of the time people think that, oh, you know what, I'm in front of the white man, right, you know, therefore I'm going to, you know, try to wiggle things out, right, and, you know, say, no, brother, it's not like this, it's not like that, right, you know. No. Believe me, they know. They exactly know where we stand. I'll give you a good example. Many years ago, I think it was 2008, there was an article published in Toronto Star, by this person who was at U of T, Noor Javed. She's a Muslim feminist. And she wrote an article on polygamy, the secret world of polygamy in Toronto. And she painted a picture as if, you know, all of you, you know, have multiple wives. And so when we came to learn about it, I went to Imam Shahryar, right, and I said, you know, Shahryar, we really need to speak against this issue here. Because what has been stated in the Quran is the last word, whether people like it or not. And then, you know, I started hearing things like even from the Imams, right, say, brothers, you know, we should be, you know, mindful of our sister's feeling, you know, and we have a modern welfare system and we don't need polygamy, you know, and this is, you know, a tradition that is back home, right, you know, as if, you know, everybody in the Middle East and, you know, and Pakistan and Malaysia and everything, you know, have multiple wives, right. So alhamdulillah, Shahryar came out and wrote a beautiful article. And the topic was that when one woman is not the one. Oh my God, there was an uproar. It was like, you know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki exploding, you know. And I started receiving emails saying, you know, you guys are backward, you know, go back home, you know, and this is Canada, you know, and we must be the law-abiding citizens of this country, as if, you know, they're all law-abiding, right, you know, and they don't break, they all stop, you know, on a red light, you know, and they never have done anything wrong, right, you know, and never cheated in the university. I by the way, all those, some of them, I happened to knew them from university, and they were cheaters. Big time cheaters, you know, they used to cheat on their exams. So, not only that, what was surprising, right, is that one brother from the Fort McMurray Islamic Center, and he was a big donor, you know. In those days, he was, I think, giving something like $500 or $800 every month to us as a donation. He sent me an angered email saying, you know, this is wrong, okay, and we are never going to accept polygamy, right, and I want my, you know, donation to stop immediately, and I want you to publish, you know, my response as well. And what I did is I published his response as is. And then I wrote him back, I said, you know what, if you are giving this donation, you are doing it for yourself. You're not doing it for me. You know, this donation was going to the, you know, poor and the orphans and the widows. So you can keep your donation to yourself. Allah will find other means for us. And alhamdulillah, Allah did. I have came across in the last 14 years individuals that I have not knew in my entire, I have not even seen their faces in my life. And they have given donations over the phone, $50,000. So, what I'm saying over here is that we must not be afraid of for our jobs. We must not be afraid of, you know, that we are going to be put into concentration camps. Because I'll tell you something, when the wind of change will come, we can suck up as much as we want to the white man. He's still going to put us in the Kingston, you know, concentration camp when the Japanese were put in 1945-46. People used to laugh at me, right, when I used to say things 5 years ago. I said, this can happen. And look what happened. Oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you, congratulations to all of you, Donald Trump won the election. Ask me why.
Why?
Because until we get the kick on our back, we are not going to put our house in order. You know, there is a beautiful couplet by Dr. Muhammad Iqbal, the poet philosopher from Pakistan, and he said, آج تجھ کو بتاتا ہوں میں تقدیر امم کیا ہے شمشیر و سنا اول طاؤس و رباب آخر میں خانہ یورپ کے ڈھنگ نرالے ہیں لاتے ہیں سرور اول اور دیتے ہیں شراب آخر. Basically what he's saying is that come and I'll tell you the secret of the rise and fall of nations. Those nations that work hard and go out and strive, they are always successful. And those nations that becomes lazy and get into luxury, they are destroyed. It is really unfortunate that Muslims, even in America, you know, thinks that they have bought big houses in Los Angeles and Houston and California or San Francisco or New York, right, you know, and they have become millionaires and there are doctors, right, you know, have, you know, multiple clinics that nothing is going to touch. They are daydreaming. So it is actually a blessing in disguise for them as well, and for all the Muslims, that things are going to become harder and harder, and then the Muslims are going to rise. Remember how Sultan Salahuddin Ayyubi came? The whole Middle East was in disarray, right? You know, everyone was fighting all these different principalities, right? You know, they were fighting each other. There were internal rivalries, and they were completely, you know, were decimated by these thugs, you know, that came from Europe. And from their ashes, then rises a man who unite the Muslim and eventually got rid of them. And it's a similar story with the Muslim in the 21st century, that we have forgot the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have left the seerah of the Prophet, we are namesake Muslims, but unfortunately in practice, in our thoughts, in our actions, we are not acting upon you know, what Allah has mandated us. So my message to all of you is, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid for your job. Don't be afraid, you know, for your university. Don't be afraid that, you know, you're going to lose the blue passport. You know, you're going to lose the blue passport, you will get a green passport. Okay? I mean, life is not going to come to an end. Okay? We may, you know, be put on the boats, right, and sent back home. Well, I'm looking forward to. I don't like winter anyway. I hate snow. So, be yourself. Show some confidence. Wherever you go, speak. But confidence with knowledge. This is very important. I'm not suggesting to any one of you that, you know, you go out, you know, and strap a bomb on your chest, right, and explode yourself. Okay? You guys are too precious to me. Okay? All of you are good to be alive and functioning and striving than going out and, you know, and doing, you know, stupid things like that. No. We must be out there and we must strive and we must deliver the message of Islam both through our belief as well as through our action. In your daily life as well as in your collective life. Now, it's very important, especially for university students, because I went through that phase. And you know, when you are in the university, you are in the MSA, right, you know, and we all sit here and say, talk about, oh, wow, you know, we are going to have a great community, right? And as soon as, you know, university completes and you get married and you call them and say, okay, Assalamu alaikum, Numan, how are you? Say, yeah, I'm busy helping my wife washing dishes right now. Okay. Well, washing dishes is not a problem. Okay. Yes. Washing dishes is not a problem, but don't forget about the community. Go out and be practical. Participate. I was yesterday talking to one of our very, you know, nice sister that I happen to know, and both Brother Marish and Brother Osta also know her, Sister Farina, right? And she came to deliver some, you know, food stuff. And we were talking about these issues there, right? And she was arguing with me the same thing, saying, you know, Brother Farooq, we cannot be isolated, you know, and we need to, you know, participate, and we need to be in the mainstream. And I said, Sister Farina, we need to put our house in order first. I said, how do you do that? You know, youth wants to get into the Islamic organizations and they want to participate, but the doors are shut. And then I told her, I said, what I went through, you know, there are 5 times I have been assaulted at work. In an Islamic organization, 5 times. Yes, don't think, you know, that like your parents, you know, mommy and daddy is going to spoon feed you everything. In real world, we have to go out and strive for it. So if you live in this vicinity, then be part of this organization. Be part of the Jama'ah. Don't be in, you know, don't take solo flights. Because the hadith of the Prophet is very clear that there is a hand of Allah on the Jama'ah. So we all need to be part of the organization. And yes, you know, you will come across that, you know, uncles usually say, okay, well, you know, you don't know what you are saying, right? They will not let you do things. Don't worry about that. You know, uncle is going to pass out after a few years. Okay? It's a natural process. It's a natural process, right? You know, they're not going to be there forever. And also, you know, because uncle could not achieve a lot in life, right? Okay, that's why they also want to show their weight, right? I say, oh, well, you know, I'm the director or something. So that's fine. Let uncle be uncle. But you guys go out, okay, and say, yes, you know, we are going to participate and we are going to bring change and we are going to do things. Be creative, you know, be innovative, as long as everything is, you know, within a certain, you know, limitation that Islam defines us. So again, thank you very much. You know, please, I apologize in advance, you know, that if I had offended anyone, if there are any disciples of any of the sheikh that I have named, right, you know, then I'm very sorry. Jazakallahu khairan, assalamu alaikum.